Schallenberger Lecture. My name is Mark Hughes. I'm the co-chair of the Johns Hopkins Hospital Ethics Committee. And Cindy Rushton and I have the pleasure of welcoming you to this lecture. She'll tell you about our speaker, Dr. Howard Brody. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Clyde Schallenberger, who we have just fantastic to see here with his wife Helen and his son Rick. Reverend Schallenberger is an icon in this institution and very instrumental to the Ethics Committee. So the Ethics Committee was formed in 1985, and Reverend Schallenberger was responsible, helpful in getting that organized. Prior to that, he worked on something called the God Squad, where it would help with difficult issues, trying to sort out patient care matters, thinking about end-of-life issues and other things that really needed the support of the staff. And he provided that not only to patients in his role as a chaplain, but also to the physicians, nurses, other staff here at the institution for 30 years, and really became a source of knowledge and support and wisdom about how to handle these tough patient care issues. He retired in the 1990s, but still continued to serve on the Johns Hopkins Ethics Committee. The annual Schallenberger Lecture was founded, the first one was in 1994, and was really an acknowledgement of his contribution to this institution. So we're honored each year to have him come and give us his presence, and also to have a guest speaker to talk about an issue relevant to contemporary ethics. So I'm going to turn it over to Cinda to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Mark, and welcome everyone, and in particular, Clyde and Helen. We're just delighted to see you again here with us. As Mark said, I am co-chair of the Johns Hopkins Hospital Ethics Committee and consultation service with Mark, and I'm also core faculty of the Berman Institute and professor in the School of Nursing. And it's my delight to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Howard Brody. Dr. Brody is both a physician and a philosopher, receiving his degrees in both of those fields, which is no small thing. He received his degrees from Michigan State University, and later was at the University of Virginia, where he did his residency. After that, he returned to Michigan State, to Lansing, where he served as the University Distinguished Professor of Family Practice, Philosophy, and also in the Center for Ethics and Humanities in the Life Sciences. He was director of that center from 1985 to 2000, and in 2006, he moved to the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston to become the director of the Institute for Medical Humanities and to take another endowed chair, the John P. McGovern Centennial Chair in Family Medicine. He's still there in an adjunct position and has been a real leader in the field of bioethics, a prolific writer. He has written many books, either as sole author or co-author, including The Future of Bioethics. He wrote, which is a pretty provocative book. He also wrote on Hooked, Ethics in the Medical Profession and the Pharmaceutical Industry, and my personal favorite, Stories of Sickness, where he really invited us to think about how narrative ethics actually applied in our everyday experience of helping people in their response to suffering. He was the president of the Society for Health and Human Values. He was also elected to the Institute of Medicine. And in 2009, he received a Lifetime Achievement Award by the American Society for Bioethics and Humanities. On a personal note, Howard is an incredibly clear thinker, a wonderful colleague, and an inspiration, I think, for our whole field. So please welcome Dr. Howard Brody.
Thanks very much, Cinda and Mark. And it's been a great pleasure of mine over the years to have been invited on several occasions to give a named lecture. And for a significant number of those named lectures, I've also had the distinct honor of the person who the lecture is named after being present in the audience. So I'd like to thank Reverend Schallenberger for his graciousness and good work here at Hopkins and establishing this lectureship. Let's see. What I want to do today is start by talking about scarcity of medical resources, which I'm going to mix up by saying we're really talking a lot about a waste of medical resources. I then want to talk about electronic records, and particularly how they're involved in money making in medicine. And by the time I'm done with that, you'll all probably feel burned out, so I want to talk then at the end about physician burnout. So what do you think of the quality of healthcare in the United Kingdom? I'm told that a number of people in the United States don't really like the United Kingdom that much, don't think that much of their healthcare. So what do you think of the quality of healthcare in Japan? Now, just for information, both those countries have more years life expectancy in birth than do the US, so it would seem like they give some kind of decent health care. But what would you think if you could have the quality and amount of health care of both those systems combined? What would that be like? And the per capita health expenditures in the United States happens to be equal to the per capita health expenditure in the United Kingdom, plus the per capita health expenditure in Japan, plus some extra. So the Physicians for National Health Program have a slogan. They talk about paying for national health insurance and not getting it. And actually, their slogan ought to be paying for two national health care systems and getting neither. Now, when we have this kind of money floating around, you question whether some of this money actually provides no benefit for patients. And the latest estimates that I've seen and that I think are significant are that at least 30% of the expenditure of healthcare in the United States probably leads to no measurable benefit to patients. And some people say that's as high as 50%. But we'll stick with 30%. And that would be, when that was first calculated back in 2012 or so, that seemed like it would be $640 to $750 billion annually. Now it's probably closer to $1 trillion annually. That money would be enough to ensure that all Americans currently not covered are insured, and then there would be extra left over that we could use to resolve the federal deficit. Now, just to give you an idea of money wasted and money that ends up going to no significant benefit, one thing that's not very well known is that taking prescription drugs as prescribed, we're not talking about overdoses, is either the third or the fourth leading cause of death in the United States. So that would be an example of some money presumably being spent ill-advisedly. Now, how can the scarcity of health resources then be an ethical problem when we're clearly wasting a good deal of money? So, I can't give a reference for this, but one thing that was said about this some years ago that stuck in my mind was, what would be the total cost of health care in the United States if everyone had access to the same level of care that was provided to Ronald Reagan after his attempted assassination? And that was presumably pretty good health care. And if everybody in the United States got access to that level of health care, the estimate was that would be 9 times the gross domestic product. Now, that may be an excessive, like I say, I can't give a reference for that, so what if that's excessive? So let's say it's 10 times too much. So that would mean instead of 9 times the gross domestic product, it's 0.9 times the gross domestic product, which is still a tremendous amount of money, much, much greater than we could ever spend on healthcare. So we seem to have the possibility that the current level of healthcare in the United States is greater than the level of healthcare in other countries that provide good healthcare for their people. But it's nowhere near the very best healthcare for everyone. So we have these ranges of different sums of money that could be devoted to healthcare. Now let's look at this from another point of view. At the same time as all that money is being wasted, we know that in the year 2007, this is before the Affordable Care Act, before Obamacare, that 62% of all bankruptcies in the United States were due to medical debt. So this is how many people became bankrupt as a result of medical debt. And what about since Obamacare? Well, we don't have similar figures for that, but we know that we do have these figures recently showing that an estimated 11.2 million Americans were pushed into poverty in the year 2015 by out-of-pocket medical expenses, which was during a year when the total number of uninsured was falling because of Obamacare. So it seems as if there's a lot of mismatch here. Now, just to show another example of some of this mismatch, let's talk about the average primary care physician. Now, if we just take the average primary care physician and look at it from the point of view of taking a textbook of medicine and turning page by page and reading what is in the textbook of medicine, about 5% of the medical conditions listed in that textbook are something that I, as a primary care physician, can treat myself. And about 95% of those medical conditions are something that I need to refer to a specialist. So it seemed like as a primary care physician, I spend all my time referring patients and hardly any time at all taking care of anybody. But it turns out that if I look at my practice as a primary care physician, 95% of the time I can treat the patient myself with no problem, and about 5% of the time I need to refer. So that tells me that 95% of patients have 5% of the medical problems. Which is saying that 95% of the patients need relatively less resources for their care, and a small number need a lot of resources for their care. And it's a mismatch. So there's these inequalities of care in the United States and elsewhere. A small number of patients require a much greater amount of care than most others. And also an inequality of access. Some in the US have easy access to greater amounts of care than others. And these are linked, because those with less access to care also tend to have greater needs. Now, there's another, take this to another level now, and let's talk about income inequality. So Wilkinson and Pickett looked at this at some depth in their book in 2009, that as income inequality increases, social and political problems, a whole group of problems related to health, crime, and various other social and political problems worsen. And the severity of these problems is only weakly associated with the national income, average income. So that the factor here seems to be the inequality of income within the country, not whether the country is rich or poor compared to other countries. So here's their major graph, that we have income inequality here from low to high, and this index of health and social problems, better and worse, here on this. Now, over here, we have countries that have low social problems and health problems, and countries like Sweden and the Scandinavian countries. And over here, we have countries, UK, Portugal, New Zealand, Greece, that have relatively higher income inequality, and they also have greater social problems. And notice there's this nice linear relationship here. Also notice that the United States is not on that graph. So where's the United States? So the United States is an outlier. Compared to other wealthy countries, which is the only countries on that graph, we have worse social political problems and greater income inequality off the scale compared to the graphs that other countries follow. Now let's go to another interesting figure. These folks, Norton and Ehrlich, decided to ask a representative online panel to estimate the current distribution of wealth in the United States and also to construct what they felt was an ideal plan. Now, the first thing we look at is to lay this out on a graph where this is the percent of wealth owned, and these are lower income people here and higher income over here. And this would be complete income equality or wealth equality. Now, I'm just showing that as an example because nobody talks about that anymore and nobody wants that. That's just there as a possibility, as a theoretical possibility. But nobody wants wealth inequality because when they ask people, what do you think ideally ought to be the distribution of wealth? People said, well, the lowest income people should make somewhat less and the highest income people should make relatively more. And that's okay. It should be unequal. Now, they then asked people, what do you think it actually is? And they said, well, it's not quite that good. If that ideal is the ideal, that the wealthy people make more money, proportionately speaking, than they should, according to our ideal plan for distribution of income. Now, that's what they thought should happen. But what actually does happen? The actual distribution is actually so far off, I couldn't even put the graph, put it on the chart. But looking at the actual numbers, according to people's ideal distribution, the top 20% would get about 32% of the total wealth. But according to people's estimate of the actual distribution, the top 20% get 58% of the total wealth. And that's wrong because according to the actual distribution, what really happens, the top 20% get about 84% of the total wealth. Now, this is not an even distribution because if you take the top 10%, you get a certain skew in the, and there's a disproportionate amount of income to the higher level. And if you take the top 1%, there's even more of a skew. If you take the top 0.1%, there's even more of a skew. If you take the top 0.01%, there's even more of a skew. So as you take smaller and smaller percentages of the population, you get more and more unequal distributions of income. And Oxfam recently looked at this and pointed out that in the year 2010, the top 43 people in the world had wealth equal to that of the lower 50% of the world population. Now, they then looked at what happened in 2017, and they said it actually changed where the top 8 people in the world had wealth equal to that of the lower 50% of the population. Those are the folks. Okay, so what I've laid out for you is some discussion of inequality of resources and scarcity of resources and inequality of resources. Now I'd like to talk some about electronic records. And what I basically want to say is what happened to this once promising development that everybody thought electronic records would be great. Are electronic records turning out to be what people thought they would be? Now, let me make this personal. I was a family physician starting in the year 1980. I entered practice, came out of residency, and I'm thinking back to that time and the letter I would receive as a primary care physician from a consultant when I sent one of my 5% of the patients off to see the consultant. And it would be a letter about usually less than a page, would be maybe half to two-thirds of a page. And it was basically say, I saw your patient so-and-so. He complained of the following things. Physical exam and labs were notable for the following things. I think he has the following disease, and I would recommend treatments A and B for that. And there might be attached a detailed visit note from his chart as a one or two page attachment or not. But I would get what I needed on that half or two-thirds page letter. That was in 1980. When I finished practicing and was about to retire from my clinical practice in 2006, I would get a 3 to 5 page note from this consultant physician. It would be an unedited copy of the chart note generated by electronic health record. It would be a very, very detailed list of history, review of systems, and physical exam. So a lot of detailed history, a lot of review of systems, a lot of physical exam. And I would say to the patient once in a while, says, looks like this doctor spent an awful lot of time with you to get all this information. And the patient would look at me with surprise, say, he was in and out in just a few minutes. So leave that aside, we won't go into that. And when I got to the end of the note, I would look to see, what am I supposed to do with this patient? What is the advice I'm getting from this person? And I might or might not have that somewhere where I could understand it in that note. Now let me take another example. This is down the road for me and up the road for me in Houston Medical Center, the MD Anderson Cancer Center. And there was a news article in this January about them. They're about to cut 1,000 jobs, 5% of their workforce. No physician jobs, fortunately, for physicians, but 5% of their total workforce were going to be cut. They did that in order to save $120 million a year. And a little while after this, the CEO resigned as a result of this. Now, why did they need to save $120 million a year? Why did they need to lay off 5% of their workforce? Well, they had this $100 million operating loss, greater than $100 million operating loss in 2016. And it was because their financial troubles began early in 2016 when it rolled out a new Epic electronic health record system. A downfall officials largely attributed to its EHR implementation project. So it seems as if it was electronic health records that caused that loss, that caused the need to lay off 5% of their workforce, and eventually caused the CEO to quit. Now, going to another place to see, is this weird? Is something just unusual about MD Anderson? Well, here was a community hospital ED where they looked at the way that physicians spent their time. And they said that 44% of their time was putting data into the computer, and 28% of their time, quite a bit less, was direct contact with patients. And they also calculated the total mouse clicks during a 10-hour shift as being 4,000 mouse clicks. Now, this was not what early electronic health records were touted to be. Examples were given of these early records from the VA system, Intermountain Health, several other places like this. And they were thought to be notable improvements in the quality of care. They reduced errors, they were efficient, and they often saved enough money to cover their initial investment. Now, this, when we go back and look at what those systems were like, it's interesting to see what happened. First of all, there were no commercial products available at the time, so these systems had to be designed from scratch. They were focused on the applicability to practice. They were very useful, very practical systems. The institution, of course, made a heavy monetary investment in them. The staff was heavily involved in the design and rollout, and so there was a heavy investment in staff training and technical support from the institution. Now, this experience, these very good records that were set up early, led to a kind of a word on the street that was bipartisan, that both Republicans and Democrats in Congress said, this is a great idea, let's get on board here. Get an electronic health record, it will do a better job, prevent errors, it will save you money. Now, then what happened is what I would call bait and switch. A new generation of electronic records arose. These were designed by commercial software companies, no longer do-it-yourself like the VA and Intermountain Health. Now, many of these software companies had no previous healthcare experience, which meant as a secondary thing that patient safety was really not part of their value system. Now, they had a couple choices. They could bring these to market slowly and take more time and get the bugs out of the system and really train the users. Or they could get it out quickly, make more money right away, and heck with the debugging and heck with user instruction. Well, guess what they did? So this led to initially a gulf in the features of electronic records and who said what about them. The rank and file started complaining. They started saying these records are burdensome, they're error prone, they're costly, they're time consuming. Now the early gung-ho leadership for electronic health records said this is a wave of the future, these complaints are anecdotal, the complainers are Luddites. They don't know what they're talking about, they're just ignorant. Now finally, recently, the leadership has started to admit the problems. So there's not so much of a gulf lately, but for quite a while there was a big gulf over these records. Now, just to show you that, example of recent data, medical economic survey, looking at primary physicians, basically two-thirds of primary physicians would not repurchase their current electronic record, dislike the functionality of their current record, say the record system has led to financial loss to the practice. The average that I'm aware of is most physicians who change over to an electronic record say they spend about 30% more time entering stuff in the record than what they did before the record. Now, Howard Stein is a medical anthropologist in the family medicine program at University of Oklahoma. And he wrote an article about this, and he wrote an article particularly featuring this fellow, Fred Winslow Taylor. Now, who's Taylor? Well, Taylor was involved in increasing labor productivity at the very end of the 19th century. And he was interested in standardization, elimination of wasted motion, and was aimed at the goal of mass production. And basically what Taylor tried to do in those years was what Henry Ford succeeded in doing when he made the Model T. He got people in the plant doing mass production and got people, instead of people working on a whole car, people would just repetitively do one thing and get the assembly line going. And basically this turned skilled craftspersons into piece workers, this system called Taylorism. And Howard Stein compared that to the influence of the electronic record. And he said, narrative data about emotions and relationships are crowded out. They do not qualify as clinical data, and there is no agreed upon place to put them. If one's only tool of documentation is a template, one might not even think of narrative, since the only option for thought is boxes to check. Now, another commentary on electronic records comes from Jean Lenzer in the BMJ this January, and she said that the elephant in the room is that electronic health records in the US are largely billing and reimbursement tools. Tracking and coding eats up provider time and has created parasitic industries in which companies charge hundreds of thousands of dollars to teach doctors how to upcode. A book that was published earlier this month by Dr. Elizabeth Rosenthal, called An American Sickness, commented on the interoperability of electronic health records. Now, interoperability is one of the goals of electronic health records. We want electronic health records to be able to talk to each other. So the idea is, if Dr. X has one record, Epic, and Dr. Y has a different record, that eventually these could talk to each other and you can exchange ideas across. And one of the problems in America is there is no interoperability. And piles of paper are mailed back and forth between electronic systems. Now, at the same time that Epic and various companies say, well, that's just the way it is, you can't do anything about it, Rosenthal mentioned that in Denmark now, Epic is building a $1 billion information technology system where securely sharing patient data, patients having direct access to data, is an essential requirement. And it's all being put in place in Denmark. So what's supposedly can't be done in the US is just impossible is possible in Denmark, because in Denmark they said, we won't pay unless you do it. But America, we're willing to pay, so we don't have it. Elizabeth Rosenthal's conclusion is, in the United States, electronic health records have evolved to put business before patients. Disjointed and siloed, they have not delivered on their promise. So, I said by now you'd be ready to talk about burnout. And I'm not going to talk a lot about burnout, but I'm going to go focus on, particularly on one article. In this recent study, we looked at a Midwestern health system. They found that 37.5% of the providers showed burnout, which is about standard. About 40% is a fairly normal outcome of this. And there was no relation to age, gender, years of service. And they talked to people and said, what do you think is going on here? And what does burnout mean to you? And so they identified four factors as being important in these folks' burnout. Intensity of workload, a high intensity of workload, a low degree of job control, a dissipated sense of the workplace as a community, and lack of congruence between staff and organizational values. So when those things are going the right way, they tend to prevent burnout. When they go the wrong way, you tend to have burnout. Now, I found out about this study through Primary Care Medical Abstracts tape. And Heather Laird Fick was a commentator on this tape. She's an internal medicine provider at Michigan State University. And she was giving this commentary. And she then added an anecdote. She noted that she herself had been facing recently both increased pressures at home and at work, and her practice had recently adopted a new electronic medical record. There was, as typical, poor support for this record and in terms of putting it into place, and in the middle of a busy clinic, the electronic record crashed. She couldn't get access to the record, and she said, I lost it. I cried in front of patients and ran out of the office. So this was her mini burnout example. She's an excellent physician. Like I say, she's a commentator on this tape. And this is how she gave an example of burnout in a low level of burnout in her own practice. So I go back to that list of factors, the high intensity workload, low degree of job control, low congruence between staff and organizational values. And I say, what is that? What's going on here? And to me, it says, this is physicians being powerless. Physicians feeling as if they cannot have control over what is going on in their own practices, and that things are being done to them that they don't like and they have no control over. Now, another example of this kind of thing going on, that is an example of powerlessness, is a hospital or is when we get into conflicts with good service versus money. And the thing I'm about to give an example of, I'll give an example at the end of where you can find out about it, but it's so many times it's been repeated, it really could be seen anywhere. A hospital or clinic system institutes new methods. These new methods improve patient outcomes. And as a result of the improved patient outcomes, there's less income for the system. Patients are healthier. They don't need more care. They don't need to be seen as often. They don't need to be seen as much. They don't need to be seen for more of the same kind of expense. And because there's less income for the system stops doing whatever they were doing. They say, we can't afford it anymore. We have to quit. Now, I mentioned burnout, and the Health Affairs blog recently had a statement on burnout, and this was a dozen healthcare executives wrote this statement. And they said, on burnout, we must make both the prevention of burnout and the restoration of the joy of a career in medicine core priorities and address this issue with the same urgent methods we would use to solve any other important business problem. Commit to measurement, develop strategy and tactics, and allocate the resources necessary to achieve success. Now, what's going on here? Notice, it's a business problem. The problem has been caused by factors generated by the increasing tailorization of healthcare, including electronic records. And what's the solution? The solution, of course, is better business practices, more tailorization. Now, a possible solution would be to say, maybe healthcare is not just another business. Maybe the problem is pretending that healthcare is just another business. But that's not considered by these CEOs. So going back to Elizabeth Rosenthal in her book, she summarizes this state of affairs as, in the past quarter century, the American medical system has stopped focusing on health or even science. Instead, it attends more or less single-mindedly to its own profits. It's now so dysfunctional, she says, quoting health economist Glenn Melnick, it's now so dysfunctional that I sometimes think the only solution is to blow the whole thing up. What do we do about this? What might we do about this? I have a radical idea, which I'll end with. How about we do away with fee-for-service and just move toward a system where all U.S. physicians are paid a salary? Now, there's a lot wrong with that, because any way you pay physicians has problems, and paying physicians a salary has problems, just like paying fee-for-service has problems. We could spend a lot of time talking about this and list this back and forth. But to the extent that fee-for-service payment is at the root of so much of this, healthcare is a business, healthcare is about profit, healthcare is about money, it's not about patient care anymore, I think something as radical as this may be necessary in order for us to get a handle on the problem and to begin some changes. To say, well, let's just do a better business plan like those CEOs did in the burnout in the electronic record is not enough. Maybe something as radical as this is needed in order to solve the problem. I'll be very interested in your thoughts about solving the problem, and thank you very much.
Are there any questions?
Income inequality is a problem that I put out there. It's not, it's a health problem, but it's much more than a health problem. And the point is, going back to the data of Wilkinson and Pickett, if you have greater income inequality, you have less good healthcare outcomes. But that's a whole series of things that are less good in your society, not just health. So when I went to my argument there was a much greater overlying system. It wasn't just healthcare, but it would go to, if you were gonna do something about income inequality, you would do something about healthcare as a part of the big picture. You wouldn't just focus on healthcare. Now, something interesting is true about the Affordable Care Act. The Affordable Care Act, which today we're trying to figure out how to get rid of, with the Republicans, and they seem to be having some problems figuring out how to get rid of it, did something interesting which didn't get very much attention at all. It was nowhere near an ideal plan in terms of fixing all the problems. We didn't insure everybody. There were many Americans still uninsured. the pharmaceutical industry got a lot that didn't want it, the insurance companies got a lot that they wanted, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But one thing the Affordable Care Act did was it was seen as, by economists, it was a income equalizing plan. It took less money from the poor and took more money from the rich to run the system. And that was a lot because of you're getting benefits to help pay for your Medicaid. So many people got extra money, and the taxes were paid by the rich, and the benefits were received by the poor. So one of the things, frankly, that has caused so much anger at the Affordable Care Act was that it was bringing more income equality to the United States. So I see this as the income inequality is a much bigger picture, of which healthcare only is a small piece. And then we could talk about electronic health records in particular ways that it shows up in healthcare. So that really isn't an answer to your question. It's something quick and dirty anyway.
Sorry. I worked at MD Anderson for 14 years. I'm very familiar with the system. And I was wondering if you have any data that would suggest that there's differences by Medicare versus non-Medicare patients in that system.
That was an interesting question about MD Anderson and the effect of Medicare and non-Medicare. I don't have that kind of information, so I think the best thing for me to do is to accept anything you want to say about it, but not it.
We're always changing information systems in terms of the lab had their own system, their own software, and then adapting to that and then moving that to somewhere else. Now, I wasn't there when Epic was installed, so that's an interesting, I don't know.
Right.
Dynamics were with Epic. But our patient department that I worked with coded every single medical record. And we had a minimum amount of information on everybody. And then we could do studies. We did about 600 studies a year, clinical studies, based on getting a cohort of patients based on the minimum data, and then going back to the record and coding for that study the specifics we needed. So we didn't try to duplicate the record, but we had access to the record in an intricate and informative way that was very helpful. And I thought the system was very efficient.
Yeah. Now, let me be negative for a minute about it and say, and that did what to help patients get healthier?
We weren't physicians. We weren't looking at that outcome. And that's the kind of study that would be very appropriate. To my knowledge, it was never done.
Right. I mean, the point is that more and more and more effort and money is being put into that kind of thing, and because for obvious reasons.
Is there a measurable outcome?
And less and less is being put into things that benefit patients. Exactly how the electronic health record triggered that loss, I don't know. I just know that they said that happened. That they went to Epic and they lost $100 million. So the details I can't tell you.
I'm Bertie Powell. I'm a chief private education student here in the chaplain department. To your solution, could you speak about how that how would that then help patient care?
Okay, thanks for that really good question. Let's see what we can do. I guess I'm suggesting that the way physicians are now paid directs physicians into a deeper and deeper and deeper commitment to things that don't matter to patients, matter to their income. So I think fee-for-service is a big part of that. So the question is not so much how do we get physicians better, as how do we get rid of this thing that is so misleading physicians. And what happened with electronic records? Did physicians go to these, see that there was, here's a record, and if I go this, I'll do all these terrible things, and therefore they think that's great, so I'll sign up for it. No, but what very often happened with these electronic records was physicians were offered some income. They could see some beneficial. They say, okay, look at this record. If I go to this course, I'll learn how to upcode, and then when I upcode, I'll make more money. So I'll learn how to figure out, and so next thing you know, people are click, 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 and spending all their time with record to upcode. And not necessarily helping patients, but they're at least, they think they're making more money, they started making more money, and then they later find out they're stuck in this horrible record that doesn't work for patients, it drives them crazy. But the thing that attracted them to the record was, hey, I can make more money. So I think that as long as we have this focus that if I just figure out a better way to code, I'll make more money, this is your getting your foot in the door. This is starting the process. And I'm suggesting, is there some way to break that off? So physicians are told, no, you don't do that. Let's talk about getting paid something decent so you're getting paid what you're worth, and let's go back to taking care of patients. So I know that's not a really good answer, but that's quick and dirty.
Right. Yeah. Thanks, Howard, for a thought-provoking talk. I found myself thinking about places like the Cleveland Clinic or the Mayo Clinic, which are touted as providing great patient care. There are also places where physicians are salaried. I mean, I know that's true about the Cleveland Clinic. I think that's also true about the Mayo Clinic. But there's also a question about whether they see the same kind of diversity in the patients they take care of. So what, since we can't all become Mayo Clinics and Cleveland Clinics, or sort of what is lost, what potentially might be lost in moving to a system where physicians are salaried and great patient care is offered, but to a certain slice of patients?
Okay, that's another great question. First of all, I think, as you say, part of the problem is just restricting it to this small group as opposed to putting it across the board. So if physicians across the board were paid on salary rather than just certain physicians, would the same thing happen? So I don't know, but that would be a question we need to ask. The second part of that is it so that what we're seeing is a consistent dedication to the good practice in the part of systems like the Cleveland Clinic and the Mayo Clinic? And I have to say that what little I know about it raises questions in my mind. The fact that how many Mayo Clinics are there now? There's a Mayo Clinic in just about every street corner. Makes me wonder about whether the Mayo Clinic really is still what it started out to be, or whether it's gradually morphing into just one more money-making system for this new plan.
What are your feelings about Dr. Ben Carson's belief that we're going to have a shortage of physicians? And B, his idea of, like in Canada, paying for medical students to go to medical school to become doctors, and then having them return in America to give back what we gave pre-medical school, like in the Army. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the question of how many doctors we have, how many doctors we need, is something I'm really not very well prepared to talk about. I would say that I would say that's mostly beyond what I'm able to talk about. I don't think I can. But sorry, I'm getting mixed up here. If I can think of what I wanted to say, I'll come back to you, okay?
Yeah,
is there any other questions? Yeah.
So I'm wondering if the system could be fixed, the EMR system, in such a way that the information that goes into it is higher quality, and maybe there's some incentives in place to have more tracking of outcomes and things like that. Could you get closer to realizing that long-term vision of having reliable data system-wide that can be used tenable in your view, or do you see that short-term obstacle is being preventing that long-term goal?
That's another great question. The situation with the electronic record appears to be, well, first of all, how many people who are opposed to the electronic record say we should throw out all electronic records and go back to paper and pencil, which we can't read anymore, right? We couldn't read them. So is that a good thing? Probably there's very few who would say that. Most people would say the right kind of electronic record would be great. Like you said, just one focused on, I mean, what are they doing in Denmark, for gosh sake? I mean, let's get a copy of that. Let's go for it. But the problem is that it would need so much development for what's now being sold to American doctors that what we have today is 1.0. We'd need 4.0, 5.0, 6.0. That it may be a while before we could get to that point. And meanwhile, you know, with the system, and what would the system have to be like to get us to that point? So I think that I find very few people who are just opposed to electronic records across the board. Most everybody says, if we could just get this darn thing working the right way, I'd be all for electronic records, but that would require this, require this, require this, and it would be a lot of the things you listed that would be required.
You hinted at this in your presentation, incentivizing dishonesty. So the complete review of systems where it's clear that the patient was never asked about all of those organ systems. Can you comment about how that impacts on either burnout or physician integrity?
That's another really, really great question. The situation has been is that with the current fee-for-service system, where you can get more money for checking this, checking that, checking this other thing, you're just at the very cusp of fraud at most every step of the process. And you know, this is what the pharmaceutical industry has unfortunately gotten into. And you know, a big pharmaceutical company has had numerous lawsuits from the federal government, which they've settled for multiple millions or even billions of dollars. And basically what a pharmaceutical company does is they come out with a new drug, they put all their money in it, and they hold a certain amount of money aside, and that's if they get sued for this drug. So it's always sort of in their plan. If we run our shop this way, we run the risk of getting sued, so we'll put some money aside and we'll use that to pay for the legal damages. Not, we run our business this way, and we run the risk of getting sued, so we better not run our business this way. So everybody takes a risk. So physicians are now increasingly taking a risk with everything they do that I could get sued if I do this, but I just better watch it. So what are these upcoding classes? They're like, do this and you won't get sued, but if you do that, you might get sued, so just be careful with the upcode. So physicians and everybody in the system are being pushed closer and closer and closer to routine fraud as a way of being, and this is part of the reason why I say that fee-for-service medicine is just wrong. We just have to quit, we have to do something different.
It's clear that you're not going to be able to just suddenly get rid of fee-for-service. You have to do gradual steps. And what do you think about sort of gradual steps of including lower ages into the Medicare program and then trying to revise within Medicare, which most of the seniors are very pleased with, trying to revise that into incentivizing more fee-for-service within Medicare? I mean, getting rid of fee-for-service within Medicare.
Right. Well, what the Physicians for National Health program is for is essentially Medicare for All.
Right.
Which would be single payer.
Right.
Now, how do you get from where we are now to single payer?
Exactly.
Well, when people say, well, let's go Medicare for All. Well, how do you go Medicare for All? Well, you would gradually expand the pool of people eligible for Medicare. So if that's what you think is the right thing to do, then that's an excellent plan. that would get you in the direction that you're trying to go.
Let's thank Dr. Brody for...
I'm so sorry, it didn't come back in my brain. I was going to try to get back to you on that, but I didn't quite get to it.
I'm a pagan medical student.